So welcome to the second unit of digital communication system. In this particular unit, we will be talking about the properties of receiver, digital receiver, which will be used to retrieve the information which has been transmitted over the channel. Now, in the first unit, we have discussed about the different types of operations which need to be performed in transmitter. For example, we have discussed about the sampling operation, which is essential for any information bearing signal to be represented in the form of discrete samples. And then we have considered about the quantization operation, which is used to make the signal discrete in amplitude. And then we have also discussed about the encoding operation, which will be used to represent the set of symbols by means of some wave patterns. Now, after you generate the symbols, that means we have a information bearing signal like this. We have the signal as a function of time. Let the signal be represented by MP. And suppose the signal is represented by any waveform. And then after the operation of sampling, quantization, and encoding operation, ultimately what you have is nothing but a set of ones and zeros. So we are representing this symbol, this entire thing, by means of a set of ones and zeros, just like this, say 1 0 0 1 1. So it could have been anything, 1 1, then 0, then 1 1 0 1, just like this. So ultimately you are representing this entire wave shape, this MT, in the form of ones and zeros. So these ones and zeros could have been represented by several means, and that part has been discussed in the line coding operation. So for NRZ kind of thing, you can represent one in a particular wave shape, and zero is represented by another wave shape. And similarly, you have RZ kind of thing, which is known as a return to zero waveform. So we have discussed different types of wave shaping technology, that is also known as the line coding techniques. Now, after the signals are represented, for example, if I just want to represent one by means of sending a pulse like this. So this is the time axis, 0 to t. So this is the amplitude axis. So one is represented by sending a pulse like this. And say, 0 is represented by sending a pulse like this. So for 1, the amplitude is plus A, and 0 is represented by sending a pulse of same duration, capital T, but here the amplitude is minus A. Now this signal is being transmitted through the channel. Now, as you know, any of the communication channel, they are bandpass in nature. That means a range of frequencies will be allowed by those channel to be transmitted. So accordingly, you can also say that the channel is a kind of low pass channel. So if the minimum signal being allowed by the channel is as low as say a few tens of hertz, and the maximum is for example few kilohertz, so then also I can consider the corresponding channel as a low pass channel, because it can pass all the low frequency. Now there could have been some channel for which it allows the signal frequency to pass through, say F1 to F2. This is the range of frequency being passed by the channel. Now, in case, so this is nothing but a bandpass channel, which allows the signal between F1 to F2 to get passed within the channel. Now, in case F1 equal to 0, that means the lower bound equal to 0 or close to 0, like few tens of hertz, say 20 hertz, 30 hertz, or say 100 hertz. So in that case, this bandpass channel can also be regarded as a low-pass channel, because it can pass the low-frequency signal. Anyway, but every time we can represent the channel as a bandpass channel, which will allow a range of frequency to get passed through it, like F1 to F2. Now, on the other hand, if we just look at the wave shape of this kind of signal, which is essentially time limited, because one is represented by transmitting one pulse of amplitude plus A and the duration T only or TB. This is the bit duration, so T or TB. So same thing. So the point which I want to mention over here is that since the signal in the time domain, is time limited, so therefore it must be band unlimited. Once again, if you observe the frequency spectrum of this kind of signal, you will find that this is nothing but a sync function. If you perform the Fourier series, I mean the Fourier transformation of this kind of signal, you will find that the Fourier pulse signal, the sync function is the corresponding in the Fourier spectrum or Fourier transformation. So as a matter of fact, you know, this sync function, the sine cx by x, I mean, if I just once again write it down, the expression for the sync function sine cx, which is nothing but sine pi x by pi x. Now, this is valid for all x. Now, whenever this is represented, this sine c function is represented as a function of frequency, that means sine c of f. So under this condition, this entire function is becoming valid for all f. Or in other words, I can say that this particular function is not at all band limited. Rather, it is band unlimited function. So what happens is, if you have a time limited signal, this is nothing but a band unlimited signal. So time limited signal, so a signal which is limited in the time domain is equivalent to same signal which is unlimited in the frequency domain. Now the problem is that you are making an attempt to transmit the same signal which is band unlimited through a band limited channel. Your signal is band unlimited, but you are making an attempt to transmit the information over a band limited channel, because already I have told you that any of the communication channel which we will use for our purpose is basically a band limited channel, a band pass channel, which will allow the signal frequency between f1 to f2 to get passed through it. So as a matter of fact, what happens whenever you make any attempt, so ultimately the signal at the output of the channel will become band limited, because the signal is band unlimited, but the channel is band limited. So as a matter of fact, the output of the channel will be band limited. Now, if the signal is band limited, then ultimately in the time domain, it will be time unlimited. So here you find that the signal is time limited, but at the output of the channel, the signal will become time unlimited. That means the extent of signal will no longer be confined between 0 to TB. Rather, it will be beyond this particular range. And as a matter of fact, whenever series of ones and zeros are being transmitted over the channel, so the corresponding waveforms for ones and zeros, they will overlap with each other. And as a matter of fact, a kind of interference will take place, which we normally refer as inter-symbol interference. So this inter-symbol interference is a particular source of noise during the transmission of this digital information. So in that inter-symbol inference, this ISI, this inter-symbol interference, ISI, which is nothing but inter, let me write it down. Inter-symbol interference. This is because of the property of the channel itself. This is because of the property of the band-limited channel. Now, hypothetically, if we can assume that we have a channel which can support a wide range of frequency, ideally from 0 to infinity, so in that case, the notion of this inter-symbol interference will not appear, because if your signal, original signal, this one, this signal, since it is time limited, so that means it is band unlimited. And if I can provide a band unlimited channel, that means a channel which supports all the frequency range from 0 hertz to few, say hundreds of gigahertz or even more, so then there will be no distortion in the wave shape, and at the output of the channel, you'll be getting the same waveform. But however, because of the limitation, physical limitation of the channel, band pass channel, so you understand that the signal for this one particular symbol, so these signals will be interfering with each other, and as a matter of fact, an ISI will occur, and this ISI will have serious implication on the bit error rate of the overall system. Now, ISI is one source of error, in case of digital transmission. And the second source of error is coming in the presence of noise. So whenever we are sending the information through the channel, so obviously we expect that the channel is not an ideal channel. It will be a practical channel, and there will be a lot of noises, externally applied noises will be there, and which will try to revert the polarity of the signal. And as a matter of fact, there is a possibility, high possibility, that one will be converted to zero and vice versa. Zero will be converted to one. So the externally applied or externally available noise is the another source of distortion, another source of non-ideality of any digital transmission system. So eventually, we will be looking at the two different sources of noise. One is the channel noise. First one is the channel noise, which will be there for any practical channel. And second one is this inter-symbol interference. So during the design of the receiver for any digital communication system, so we must consider each of these two noises, and we have to take proper means so that these noises could have been eliminated to some extent. Because you know that noise cannot be eliminated completely. The effect of the noise can be reduced to some extent, but you cannot eliminate it completely. And to understand the effect of noise, so there is one parameter which is popularly employed in any digital communication system, which is known as bit error rate, or in short, BER. So you will be encountering this particular parameter many a times in this particular course, bit error rate or BER. What does it mean? So since in case of digital transmission, we are representing the signal, this information carrying signal, sinusoidal or any kind of signal, by means of some bits like 1001101, like this. So ultimately, suppose you are sending, for example, you are sending 10 to the power 6 bits. You are sending 10 to the power 6 bits to represent that particular signal. And out of these 10 to the power 6 bits, you have found that one bit is in error. That means at the receiver side, out of 10 to the power 6 bits, all the bits are received properly except one bit. So this bit error rate is then defined by the number of bits in error divided by the total number of bits. So total number of bits is 10 to the power 6, and number of bits is 1, which is in error. So ultimately, this bit error rate is equal to 10 to the power minus 6, for example. So a typical value of BER is like 10 to the power minus 5, 10 to the minus 6, 10 to the minus 7. So anything which is lower than 10 to the power minus 5 to 10 to the minus 6 is well acceptable value of BER for any digital communication system. So while designing the receiver side, so our major emphasis will be to reduce the effect of these noises, channel noise and ISI, to some extent, so that the value of BER can be minimized. Now, this particular discussion on this receiver will be divided into two different segments. So in the first segment, we'll be discussing about the discussion on this mass filter receiver, which will take care of the channel noise. And then in some subsequent lectures, we will be discussing about the inter-symbol interference, or ISI in short. Let me start with the first one. So let us consider that this receiver is being represented by means of a simple LTI filter. LTI filter of the impulse response HT. So what do you mean by LTI? So if you know this one, it is fine. Otherwise, let me introduce once again. Probably this has been discussed in the signal systems course. So this is nothing but linear time invariant. Time invariant can be written together, or sometimes it is also known as linear shift invariant. If the parameter, if the independent parameter is other than time, then I can also refer this particular filter as linear shift invariant filter, or LSI system, or LSI filter. And so for the variable to be time, so we can safely use the term LTI, or linear time invariant system, or linear time invariant filter. Now what happens for a linear time invariant filter? it must obey the superposition law, because since it is linear, so it must obey the superposition law. So what do you mean by the superposition law? So suppose I'm having an LTI system, and suppose the input to the system is say XT, and the output to the system is say YT. Now, for the input X1T, suppose the output is Y1T, and for the input X2T, say the output is Y2T. Now, the superposition theorem says that for any arbitrary constant alpha 1 and alpha 2, because of the input alpha 1 x1t plus alpha 2 x2t, the corresponding output developed by the system is nothing but alpha 1 y1t plus alpha 2 y2t. Now, if this condition gets satisfied, then I can say that the system is LTI in nature. That means both the additivity as well as the homogeneity, so these two properties are satisfied by the system. So let me once again summarize briefly. I'm having one LTI system for which the input is XT and the output is YT. Now, if I know that for the input X1T, the output is Y1T, and for the input X2T, the output is Y2T, then for the input alpha 1 X1T plus alpha 2 X2T, the output will become alpha 1 Y1T plus alpha 2 Y2T. Now, if this condition is satisfied, then I can say that the system is linear in nature. And what about the time invariance property? Now, for the input XT, your output is YT. Now, if for the input XT minus tau, if the output being the same and shifted by the same time instant tau, then it is known as time invariant system. That means whenever the input signal is shifted by some constant tau, then the output signal is also being shifted by the same constant tau. So now, if this property is satisfied, then this particular system is known as time invariant system. Now, as you understand, for any linear time invariant system, both the linearity as well as the time invariance property will be satisfied simultaneously. Now, that is all about the discussion about LTI. Now, suppose we have in the receiver block, suppose this LTI filter is used to retrieve the information. And suppose this is nothing but the channel output. This is the channel output. And at the output of this LTI filter, let us check what we are getting. Now, suppose the original signal, so let me represent the original signal, original pulse waveform. That means the message signal, ultimately 1 and 0, these are the two symbols, and the symbols are being represented by sending some pulses. So pulse waveform is being represented by, say, let it be like MT. This is a pulse waveform. That means this one. Let me go to the previous slide. That means this one. So this is the MT signal. Although in this particular case, MT is nothing but this time-varying waveform, but for the discussion, let us assume that this is the MT signal, message signal, which is nothing but the representation of the symbol 1 or 0. So make no mistake, this is MT, this one. So this is the original pulse waveform MT. And suppose we have another signal, this is the noise, channel noise. So there will be contribution regarding the channel noise. So we must mention this one as well. Suppose the contribution resulting from the channel noise is NT. Let it be say MT over here. So let it be say some WT. So what will you get over here at the input of the LTI filter? So at the input of the LTI filter, if this is XT, so I'm assuming that the channel noise is additive in nature. That means it adds with the original pulse waveform. So I can write this channel output to be the summation of this MT and WT. Now here we are making one assumption that WT is nothing but a sample of parity white Gaussian noise. So as you understand, this AWGN, which is very popular in any communication environment, AWGN kind of noise. What do you mean by AWGN? Let me try to explain each and every component of it. Additive. W means white and G means Gaussian. And N signifies noise. So what do you mean by additive noise? That means this particular noise is always added with the signal. So here the signal is empty. The original pulse waveform, like this one. This is the pulse waveform. See, this one is A, this is TB. So this is the pulse waveform. So whenever you are considering this AWGN kind of noise, then the noise always gets added with the signal. So that's why this is known as additive signal. Why white? White because if you just observe the frequency characteristics of the noise, you will find that in the frequency domain, you will find that this corresponding power spectral density is a constant, is a flat one. So what do you mean by power spectral density? So power spectral density gives you some idea regarding the distribution of the power with respect to the frequency. So obviously the noise signal will be having some power content. Now, how does this power content vary with the frequency? That will be understood from the value of power spectral density. Now, if the power spectral density is a flat one, is a constant one like this, that means all the frequency components are present within the noise signal in equal proportion. So that's why it is constant throughout. So suppose this is 0 hertz, and this one is say few, say hundreds of megahertz or even higher. So that means all the frequency components are present, and the power contribution resulting from each of these frequency components are being the same. And this particular behavior is identical to a color white, because you know that white color is nothing but the presence of all the colors in equal proportion. If we consider VIPGOR, then all the seven colors, if you mix all the seven colors in equal proportion, then you'll be getting the white color. So since here all the frequency components are present in equal proportion, so that's why this particular noise is known as white noise. Then why Gaussian noise? Because since it's a noise, so you understand that it is not at all a deterministic signal. Rather, it's a probabilistic signal. So therefore, at any particular instant, you never know what will be the value of the noise. So that's why in order to characterize the noise, you have to, and you need to know rather, some probability distribution function of the noise. And this is, for this type of noise, this probability distribution function is given by a Gaussian shape, just like this. This is the noise value, so this is the PDF. And this is the noise component, let it be like W. So how does this probability occurrence of W varies with the value of W? It's a bell shaped. So that's what's a Gaussian shape. So this is the mean. So here I have considered the mean to be zero. So otherwise the mean could have been non-zero. So in that case, the entire waveform might be shifted in the right hand side. So if I consider that this particular noise is having some non-zero mean, non-zero positive mean, then this entire bell shape will be shifted towards the right side. And if I consider that the mean value or the average value of this particular noise is negative one, that means the mean is negative. So in that case, it will be shifted towards this left side, and the peak of the bell is identifying the mean value of that particular random variable. So here I am considering that this random variable is having a zero mean. And as you understand, this particular width is having some serious implication regarding the variance of the particular random variable. So I'm not going into the mathematical part of this description. How is this represented mathematically? You know this one, 1 by sigma root 2 pi e to the power minus x minus m whole square by 2 sigma square. So this is the mathematical derivation of this particular probability density function. So I'm not going into that. So what I want to mention over here is that this particular channel noise is additive in nature. That means it will be added with the original pulse waveform empty, and it will be white in nature. So that's why all the frequency components are present in equal proportion. And thirdly, if I just observe the corresponding probability distribution function, so it will look like a Gaussian function. So that's why it is known as a Gaussian noise. So ultimately, this channel noise WT is added with the input signal, rather the original pulse waveform MT. And as a matter of fact, we are getting what is known as the channel output or XT. Now, this channel output is being provided to the input of an LTI filter. Now, as you understand, since it's an LTI filter, so the output of the filter will be nothing but the addition of the individual input. Now, here you have two inputs like MT and WT. And since the filter is linear in nature, so as a matter of fact, the output YT is nothing but, say, let it be like GT plus NT. GT plus NT. Now, what is that? GT is the output of the filter because of MT only. So whenever MT is acting alone, the output will be GT. And whenever WT is acting alone, then the output will be NT. Now here, since the input to the system, input to the LTI filter, is the summation of these two signals, MT and WT. So therefore, being a linear filter, the output of the filter is given by GT plus NT. So GT is the signal component over here, and NT is the noise component over here. Now this YT is obtained over here by means of GT plus NT. And then, depending upon the individual contribution of GT and NT, the receiver has to predict whether the signal being transmitted during that particular interval is a 0 or 1. So what is the objective of the receiver? So at the output of the receiver, so let me once again draw it. So we have LTI filter. Now at the output, so we have YT, which is nothing but the signal component GT plus the noise component NT. Now out of these two components, signal component is a deterministic one. Because you know what are the signal being transmitted in any particular interval. And whenever the signal is passing through this particular LTI filter, you know what will be the corresponding output, because for an LTI filter, the output is nothing but the convolution between the input and the impulse response. So this particular GT is completely deterministic. And however, this one, this NT is probabilistic in nature, because you never know at any particular instant what will be the corresponding value of the noise. So therefore, in order to characterize this noise component NT, we need to take the help of some probabilistic variable. Okay, I think I can do one thing. I can, one second. This is LTI filter. So at the input, you have XT. At the output, you have YT. At the output of the filter, YT is obtained. Now, there will be a sampler. There will be a sampler which will sample the output value YT after every T seconds. And based on the value of YT at any particular instant T, the decision will be taken whether the transmitted signal was 0 or 1. So at the output of the LTI filter, you have got YT. Now this YT is sampled after every T second, because T is the symbol duration here. So after every T second, this one will be checked in the decision block, and there is a threshold inbuilt within the decision block. Now if the value of YT at particular T, capital T, if the value is greater than the threshold, In that case, a decision will be made in favor of symbol 1. And if the value of yt at any particular capital T, if this is less than this threshold, then the decision will be made in favor of 0. That means if yt at t is equal to capital T, if this is less than lambda, which is the threshold, then the decision is made in favor of symbol 0. And if yt at t is equal to capital T, if this is greater than lambda, the threshold, then the decision will be made in favor of symbol 1. So here lambda is the threshold. So lambda is the threshold, which is the inherent property of the decision device. So here our basic objective is to design this LTI filter in such a way so that for any given noise component, the signal power can be enhanced as much as possible. So we have yt as a summation of two signal, gt plus nt. So we need to optimize the design of the filter HT, because HT is the impulse response of the LTI filter. And you know, for an LTI filter, and this is completely identified by its impulse response HT. So we have to find out the expression for HT, which can maximize the signal power with respect to the noise power. So therefore, let us define one parameter, which is known as peak signal to noise ratio. So this peak signal to noise ratio eta is nothing but the signal power at time t is equal to capital T. So we have the signal as yt, and this is sampled at every t is equal to capital T. So the signal power is the gt square, mod gt square, and the average noise power. So this is the ratio between these two variables. So for signal, I have written like gt mod gt square, because the signal is a deterministic one. So we have yt at the output of the LTI filter, and this yt is sampled after every t seconds, every capital T second. So therefore, the signal component can be easily obtained by this g capital T mod square, assuming that the signal might be complex. So that's why we have used mod here. But what about the noise component? I cannot simply write n square t over here. Why? Because signal is a deterministic one, this gt, but this noise is probabilistic. So that's why I cannot write simply n square t. Rather, I have to take the expectation operation. So expectation is nothing but the average or mean operation, which is applied over any probabilistic signal. Since this the source of nt, which is nothing but wt, is nothing but a simple sample of a random variable, awg and random variable. So the noise is of AWGN type, and a sample of this AWGN random variable is being represented by WT. And when this WT is being passed through this LTI system, then the output is obtained like NT. So therefore, in order to obtain the average power component present within the noise signal NT, so I have to take the help of this expectation operation, which is nothing but a simple mean operation. So this gt mod gt square, which is there in the numerator, is the signal power, and expectation of n square t, which is there in the denominator, is nothing but the average noise power. So the primary objective of for the design of this LTI filter is to maximize the value of this eta, because this is the peak pulse signal to noise ratio, and our primary objective will be to maximize this particular ratio. Accordingly, I have to design the LTI filter. Now, first of all, once again, let me draw the same block diagram. So here you have mt plus wt, and at the output you have gt plus nt. Then Then what will be the relation between this MT and GT? So you understand that since it's an LTI filter, so therefore the GT is nothing but the convolution between this MT and the impulse response of the LTI filter. So in the natural domain, I can write GT, which is the signal output because of the MT, because of the signal MT only. So this is nothing but the convolution between the signal MT and the impulse response HT. And in the frequency domain, this could have been represented like G of F. In the frequency domain, you understand that this is nothing but the product of the individual frequency components like this, MF into HF. In the natural domain, these two signals are convolved to obtain GT. So in the frequency domain, this MF and HF, so their corresponding frequency spectrums are multiplied. So this is a very useful property of a Fourier transform, that convolution in the natural time domain is equivalent to multiplication in the frequency domain and vice versa. So here the convolution has been carried out in the natural time domain between MT and HT, because the filter LTI, because the filter over here, which we are using over here, is an LTI filter. So that's why the corresponding output is represented as the convolution between the input and its impulse response. So therefore, GF can be represented like MF multiplied with HF. Then, in order to obtain the GT, what you need to do is, in order to get GT, so GT is nothing but the inverse Fourier transform of GF. So that could have been written like GF into e to the power j twice pi ft df. So now if you just put the value of GF over here, you'll find that this is nothing but MF into HF into e to the power j twice pi ft df. Now this is the value of GT for any particular t. Now we are calculating the value of GT at t is equal to capital T. So that's why, in order to find out G of capital T, I have to replace the small t by capital T in both sides of the equation. So this is nothing but MF into HF into e to the power j twice pi f capital T df. Now comes the noise power, the average noise power. So initially we have assumed that this noise sample, this WT, is a sample of a AWGN random noise with a power spectral density n0 by 2. That means the power spectral density which you have considered over here, suppose the value equal to n0 by 2. That means the constant value is n0 by 2 throughout. Now you have, for the noise signal, in the frequency domain, if I observe, suppose the power spectral density of the input noise is SWF and the power spectral density of the output noise, let it be SNF, then the relation between SWF and SNF is that, is SNF is nothing but the output power spectral density, SNF is nothing but input power spectral density, that is N0 upon 2, multiplied with mod of HF square. So this is the relation. the input power spectral density and the output power spectral density of any random signal. Now, if I have a random signal like SWF, for which the power spectral density is constant because it's a sample of AWGN noise, and since it's a white noise, so therefore the power spectral density will be constant throughout. So the input power spectral density is not a function of frequency, rather it's a constant, so that's a N0 by 2. So the output power spectral density is given by the input power spectral density multiplied with the mod of the frequency spectrum square. So frequency spectrum over here is HF, so mod of HF square. So this is nothing but the power spectral density. Then how to find out the total power? So as you know, the total power is nothing but the collection of the contribution of each frequency for this power spectral density. Now, here, if I write it down, so E of N squared T, which is nothing but the average power resulting from the noise signal. So this is nothing but the average power. So we have already got the output power spectral density like SNF. So this is the power spectral density. That means the contribution of the noise power with respect to frequency. So how to find out the total power? So you need to integrate it over the entire range of frequency. So this is nothing but minus infinity to plus infinity SNF TF. So SNF will give you the distribution of the noise power with respect to frequency. So if I put the value, it will be nothing but N0 by 2 minus to plus infinity mod of HF square DF. Now if I put this one in the expression of theta, so in the numerator you have mod GT square, and in the denominator you have E of N squared T. And here our objective is to maximize this particular variable. So I need to put the value of GT over here. This is nothing but minus to plus infinity MF HF into e to the power J twice pi FT DF mod square. And here in the denominator, you have N0 by 2 minus to plus infinity mod HF square DF. Now, how to maximize this particular parameter? Now, in order to maximize this particular parameter, we need to take the help of an inequality, which is known as Schwarz inequality. Schwarz inequality, which says that if I have two complex functions of a variable, suppose I am having two complex functions, pi 1x and pi 2x. With the condition that this one, mod pi 1x whole square dx, is bounded, and the second function is also bounded. If these two functions are bounded, then mod of pi 1x pi 2x dx mod square is less than or equal to these individual modes. So this is a well-known property in complex variable. Pi 2x dx. Now I have to take the help of this particular property to maximize the value of eta. Now here, if you find that the numerator, I am having mf hf and e to the power j twice by ft df as the variable. So I can equate phi 1x to mf and phi 2x to hf e to the power j twice by ft. Now under this condition, let me write it down. Let me simplify this one. In the numerator, we have this expression mod of minus to plus infinity mf hf e to the power j twice by ft df mod square. So this is always less than or equal to minus to plus infinity mf square df and minus to plus infinity mod hf square df. So intentionally I have written like hf square because you know that mod of e to the power j twice by ft will always be 1. So that's why it will be basically mod of hf e to the power j twice by ft whole square, but mod of e to the power j twice by ft is always 1. So that's why mod of hf square df. Now under this condition, if I once again write it down the expression for eta, so now eta will be less than or equal to minus to plus infinity mod of mf square df minus to plus infinity mod of hf square df. This is the numerator, and in the denominator we have n naught by 2 minus to plus infinity mod of hf square df. So to maximize the value of eta, so eta is restricted by this value. So this could have been the maximum value of eta because eta is less than or equal to this value. So the highest possible value of eta is given by this one. Then the next question is that when does eta achieve this highest value? So in this particular Schwarz inequality, we have mentioned that if we have two variables like phi 1x and phi 2x, I mean two functions of our variable x, and if these conditions are satisfied, then minus to plus infinity phi 1 square x dx less than infinity and minus to plus infinity phi 2x square mod square dx less than infinity, that means these two functions are having finite energy in nature. In that case, this particular inequality will be satisfied. Now the equal sign will be there if and only if phi 1x is equal to phi k phi 2 star x. So if this condition is satisfied, then we do have an equal sign. Under this condition, we do have this equal sign. So equal sign will be obtained if and only if these two functions are related by this particular formula, phi 1x equal to k phi 2 star x. So here also, the eta max, the maximum value of eta will be obtained. Eta max, as you understand, eta max is nothing but the thing which I have already written over here, minus to plus infinity. I think it will be better to, I mean, to write beneath this one. So this eta max will be nothing but minus to plus infinity mod mf square df minus to plus infinity mod hf square df divided by n naught by 2 minus to plus infinity mod hf square df. Now this condition gets satisfied. The condition is that, let me write it down, the condition for eta max is, condition for eta max is phi 1x must be equal to k phi 2 star x. So that means MF must be equal to some constant k multiplied with the complex conjugate of this one. So that means this is A star F into e to the power minus j twice pi F capital T. So if this condition gets satisfied, that MF is equal to k A star F e to the power minus j twice pi F T, then only eta max will be obtained. Now under this condition, what will be the value of eta max? So these two will be cancelled out. Now ultimately we have minus to plus infinity mod MF square DF. I think it will be better to write it down below this one, otherwise it might create some confusion. So this is equal to minus to plus infinity mod of MF squared DF divided by N naught by 2. So this is equal to 2 by N naught minus to plus infinity mod of MF square DF. So this could have been the maximum value of this eta, peak pulse signal to noise ratio, and this maximum value is obtained if and only if this particular condition gets satisfied. That means this one, yeah, the condition is MF must be equal to k A star F e to the power minus j twice pi FT. So if this condition gets satisfied, then only we will be getting the maximum value of eta. So under this condition, if we quickly calculate the expression for HF over here, the condition is MF is equal to some constant k A star F e to the power minus j twice pi F T. E to the power minus j twice pi ft. So that is the condition which needs to be satisfied. Now here our objective is to find out the value of HF. So to find it out, what I can do is I need to find out HT or HF, which is nothing but the impulse response of the LTI filter. So this is nothing but the inverse Fourier transform of HF. So let me write down the expression of that. Or rather, it will be better if I write optimum value of HT. So this is nothing but H optimum F into e to the power J twice by FTTF. Then what about H opt of F? So this H opt of F can be obtained from this particular formula. So this formula says that H opt F complex conjugate is given by so let it be some 1 by k over here into MF into ए टू दी पावर जे ट्वाइस बाई एफ कैपिटल टी। If I put the hello over here, say 1 by k, I can always write this one as some other constant like k1. So k1 mf e to the power j twice by f capital T. This is the expression for h opt star f. Then what about h opt f? So I need to take this is star f, so I think we need to find out the complex conjugate of that. So assuming that this one is a constant one, k1, so h opt f can be represented by k1 m star f e to the power minus j twice by f capital T. If I put this one, this value of h opt f over here, I'll find that this is nothing but k1 m star f e to the power. Now we have two function e to the power j twice by f small t multiplied with e to the power minus j twice by f capital T df. Now, if the signal is real in nature, because you know that we have represented MT, the actual pulse signal, by means of sending some pulse of either positive amplitude or negative amplitude. So, as a matter of fact, if a signal MT is real in nature, then this condition also holds good. We can always check this one, that M star F is given by M of minus F. This is coming directly from the property of the Fourier transformation, that for real signal MT, this M star F is given by M of minus F. If I do this substitution over here, I'll find that we have some constant K1 over here. Then we have M of minus F e to the power J twice by FT and e to the power minus j twice by f capital T df. So I can take k1 outside. And if I do the substitution, f is equal to minus f, that substitution if I do, then I'll find that ultimately it can be represented by this form mf into e to the power j twice by f capital T minus small t into df. As you know, mf e to the power j twice by ft df integration over minus infinity to plus infinity will give you mt only. I think it will be better if I go to the next slide. So what we have is h optimum t, the optimum value of the impulse response is given by some constant k1 outside with minus to plus infinity mf e to the power j twice by f t minus t df. Now, as you know, integration over minus to plus infinity mf e to the power j twice by ft df is nothing but the inverse Fourier transform of mf. That means this is equal to m of t. And here, if this condition is true, then here instead of small t, I do have capital T minus small t. So therefore, this is nothing but k1 multiplied with m of capital T minus small t. So this is the ultimate formula which we are looking at, that h optimum is the optimum value of the impulse response of the LTI filter, which is used in the transmitter of that particular communication system, is represented by some constant k outside or k1 outside. And we do have m of capital T minus small t. What is the implication? That except this scaling factor k1 outside, the impulse response of the LTI filter is nothing but the time reversed and delayed version of the message signal MT. So actually, we have started with sending pulse waveform like this. So this was the signal MT for the symbol 1. And for the symbol 0, suppose this is class A. And for symbol 0, this was represented by sending a pulse of amplitude minus A with a duration capital T only. So the optimum value of the impulse response is given by some constant. So I'm just neglecting constant right now because this constant is having no implication as far as the detection of the symbols are concerned. Then it is multiplied with the signal M capital T minus small t. What is the implication of capital T minus small t? Now you have for this particular MT, if I now draw the M of minus t, how does it look like? M of minus t. So M of minus t looks something like that. This is M of minus t, minus capital T. So MT ranges from 0 to capital T. So therefore, M of minus T is ranging from 0 to minus T. And this operation is known as folding operation, a time reverse operation. Folding or time reversal. Time reversal. And after this time reversal, we do have a shifting because now M of capital T minus small t, not M of minus t only, rather M of capital T minus small t. So that means that particular thing is shifted by capital T amount. Now, if the signal is shifted, so this is T. So this is T. Now we are shifting this waveform by capital T amount. Then ultimately, what we have is M of capital T minus small t. Means ultimately we will be getting the same waveform, class A. And this is equal to your H of optimum T, H of T. Obviously, there is some constant K1 outside. But as far as the wave shape is concerned, you see that the impulse response of the LTI filter is completely matched to the pulse waveform which you have transmitted from the transmitter side. So that's why, since the impulse response is completely matched with the pulse waveform, and for the LTI filter, since it is completely characterized by its impulse response, so that's why this type of filter is known as a matched filter receiver, because the impulse response is completely matched with the input waveform which you have transmitted from the transmitter side. Now, for this particular case, once again, if I just go back to the expression of eta or eta max, so we have seen that eta max is given by 2 by n naught into this integral, minus 2 plus infinity mod mf squared df. So under this condition, let me write it down, the expression for eta max, the maximum value of this signal to noise ratio, this was like, two by n naught and minus two plus infinity mod of mf squared df. Now, according to Rayleigh's energy theorem, we know that minus two plus infinity mod mt squared dt is equal to minus two plus infinity mod mf squared df, and which is nothing but the energy of the signal mt. So therefore, this is nothing but the energy of the signal. So ultimately, eta max is given by 2e by n naught. Or rather, it could have been also represented by e by n naught by 2. So here, the unit of e is in joules because this is the energy of this particular waveform. You can easily calculate the energy of this waveform. So therefore, the energy is in joule. This E is in joule. and n naught by 2 is the power spectral density. So since it's a power spectral density, that means the power per frequency. So I can write this one is in unit of watt per hertz. So ultimately, this joule in the numerator and watt per hertz in the denominator. So you can easily find out that the eta max will be unitless, because joule in the numerator and here you have watt per hertz. So watt per hertz is nothing but watt into second. So watt into second is joule. So numerator, denominator, both of them are having the same unit. So ultimately this eta max will be unitless. The another thing which we must note from this particular expression of eta max is that the wave shape of the signal is not at all important here. In order to maximize or in order to have the eta max, this is represented by E by another 2E by N naught. So as long as this N naught is fixed, that means the power spectral density of the random noise is constant. That means N naught by 2 is fixed. The value of N naught by 2 is fixed. The eta max can be maximized just by changing the value of the energy of the signal, energy of this particular pulse waveform. So suppose I do have these two waveforms. So as you understand, the first one is for sending one, this one is for sending one, and this one is for sending zero. Now here the amplitude is plus A, here the amplitude is minus A, and in both the case, the duration is capital T. So therefore, if you compute the energy of these two particular signals, so you'll find both of them are providing the same energy. So as a matter of fact, whether you transmit one or you transmit zero by virtue of these two different waveforms, the energy content present within the signal will be unique. So as a matter of fact, the eta max will be the same. So what I want to mention here is that the eta max has nothing to do with the wave shape. Rather, it depends upon the signal energy. So to some extent, you can increase the eta max just by increasing the amplitude level over here. So here, suppose here you are using a value of 1. So you can increase this 1 to 2 in order to increase the value of the energy of this particular signal. Otherwise, eta max is a function of N naught by 2. And as far as the property of the noise is concerned, so we do agree that we don't have any control over the property of the noise, because it is appearing randomly during the transmission of the signal through the channel. And the maximum thing what we can do is that we can characterize the noise signal by its probabilistic property, which we have already mentioned over here. Some statistical property we can mention over here. So the only thing, only control which we can possess is that particular variable E, this energy of the signal, which we can maximize by increasing the amplitude level over here, but at the cost of more power loss, because as you increase the amplitude level over here, the transmitted power will be much more. So as a matter of fact, it can hamper the power efficiency of the system. So ultimately, we would like to mention over here from the today's discussion is that, so once again, if I just go back to the first slide, that here our objective is to design one system, the filter, the LTI filter over here, which can maximize the peak pulse signal to noise ratio for any given channel output XT, which can be represented by some the signal original pulse waveform plus the noise component resulting from the channel noise. And to maximize the signal power with respect to the noise power, we have developed the expression for this impulse response of the LTI filter. And as you know, since it's an LTI filter, so the impulse response completely characterizes the system. And after mathematical deductions, what we have observed is this impulse response of this LTI filter can be represented as the pulse waveform, except the constant over here, except this scalar constant. This impulse response is being represented by the pulse waveform shifted and time reversed. So in case of m of t, we have m of capital T minus small t. So minus t is having the implication of time reversal or folding, and capital T minus small t means the corresponding shifting. So from mt to m capital T minus small t, in order to get that particular waveform, we do need to provide two operations. One is known as the time reversal, and the second one is known as the shifting operation. Now, after you perform these two operations together, time reversal and shifting, you will find that m of capital T minus small t is exactly equal to m of t. That means the impulse response of the LTI filter is completely matching with the original pulse waveform. So as a matter of fact, this particular filter is known as matched filter, and this matched filter is extensively used to detect the signal from its corrupted version. Now, with this, I would like to conclude today's discussion on matched filter receiver.